Now, how can we protect ourselves from these online scams? Let's ask the agency that sounded the alarm on these scams, the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center. CICC Executive Director, Undersecretary Alexander Ramos, joins us on the show. USEC, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. Now, with the UNDAS holidays ongoing and the Christmas holidays approaching, could you elaborate on the specific challenges, of course, that your organization is anticipating in terms of e-wallet scams, which right now we're finding is to be the most common?
Yes. Well, as far as these scams are concerned, we have detected in the past cases, actually 1 year ago, we studied the kind of modus operandi they do, no? Mm-hmm. And there's a spike during long holidays that occur in the country, and the victims are not aware of it. In fact, this is what you call the harvesting period, wherein most of the targets will feel the impact after the holiday season itself. The modus operandi here is really, number one is phishing. And the objective of the system that they have is send out massive messages targeted to different numbers. It's like to whom it may concern. And whoever responds to it will be a captured victim. Now, as far as this this operation that was caught by our law enforcement, your NBI, in Pasig, this is precisely the kind of operation that the unmanned, actually it can run unmanned, no? Mm-hmm. They send out thousands of messages per minute, victimizing as many as possible to trap a potential victim. It is not very focused, as in they will steal everybody's numbers and send you messages. No, that's not the technique. The technique is send it to as many SIM card holders as it can reach. So it's a bullet for everyone. And all we have to do is be wary of these messages, especially during the holidays, that we have our guards lowered because we are traveling and we are harassed. We are too busy to look into our personal safety. These things would really pass through like a... very fast and targeting victims.
Are there any new trends or techniques, USEC, that you're seeing that scammers are employing specifically during the holiday season that the public should be particularly cautious about? I mean, aside from phishing scams.
Well, the objective of these syndicates is to catch online financial accounts.
And you mentioned...
That's where they could start...
Go ahead, USEC, sorry.
Yeah. Your online financial accounts, like your online wallets, whether it's a bank base or in your online payment platforms, you know, they will target those accounts to siphon off whatever funds you have. Of course, that starts with a phishing activity to enable them to capture your account, your credentials, black you out, and start withdrawing your money from them.
And we talk about that sometimes people do tend to lower their guard when they're on vacation during holidays. Now, after someone finally comes to their senses and, you know, they finally suspected that they have been targeted by a scam, what immediate steps should they take to protect their e-wallet accounts?
Okay, the first thing they will do, the moment they lose control of their SoftMed accounts or online accounts, is to warn immediate friends and family. That's the first thing you do to alert them, because most likely they will be the next victims to that. Secondly, once they have done that, they should communicate immediately to their banks, okay, or to the online platforms, which can make the necessary immediate steps to protect their accounts online, no? So that's the second step. Of course, the third step, they have to report it to allow us to warn others to be wary that there is this ongoing trend, so that those numbers that attack them, we can track them down and stop it from victimizing other potential victims.
Now, creating fake e-wallet apps, it's becoming a very concerning trend. Yusek, how can users differentiate between legitimate e-wallet apps and sometimes upcoming fake ones, especially when the scammers are also becoming more sophisticated in their designs? Could you give any specific red flags or signs that users should look out for to identify these fake e-wallet apps?
Okay, the most common first. Mm-hmm. The unwarranted messages we receive coming from a bank. It's lucky if the bank you have an account with the bank account, then you would take consideration. But again, the modus operandi here is that they send out massive messages to whom it may concern, whether you are an account holder of that bank or not. Banks don't do this. Okay, it is important to note your banks, the banks, no. They don't do this online. If there's a problem, an account officer will call you to come to the branch and discuss the problem. So if you have an account problem, it is not discussed online by text or by calls online. You always go to the bank to your where your account is. As far as online wallets are concerned, neither do they do these alerts. They would alert you if there is a big problem, then they will send appropriate messages using official application in your official application in your cell phones. Because what happens is that when you receive a message, sometimes the alert is sending a link towards that will redirect you towards a different platform. That's already a red flag there. Do not panic, okay? Read carefully, look at it carefully if it is from official platform applications or official communication sent by these financial institutions.
And now referral campaigns, they're really widely used by e-wallets. What precautions should individuals take to participate safely in these campaigns, you know, without risking their account security? You know, if someone suspects that a referral campaign already that they've encountered might be fraudulent, how can they verify its legitimacy before getting involved?
Referrals are common. Mm-hmm. So to differentiate that is that official referrals are mostly written. That's as far as we are concerned, no? Because we have sat down recently with GCash, we sat down with several banks already. There are things that they don't do. In fact, for their authentication process, they do real-time, live authentication already by video. Hindi na pwede lumusot yung mga still images for authentication. So to differentiate is avoid first, avoid unnecessary clicking of messages that did not come from official channels.
Now, public Wi-Fi usage poses quite a potential risk as well. We just had a report about it. Could you elaborate on the security vulnerabilities associated with using public Wi-Fi networks? And how can individuals secure their e-wallet transactions in such environments, especially in airports, malls?
Okay, we have these continuous warnings mm-hmm. on the usage of public Wi-Fi. You see, there's what you call the official public Wi-Fi. Again, the security here is very low because it's public in nature. If it pertains to financial transactions, please avoid it. You can use your personal access. You see, I'm not promoting the telcos that to have them use their internet access, no? But it is the safest right now. If you value your security, if you value your personal information, use your personal access. But in the worst case scenario that you need to use a public Wi-Fi, avoid using it for financial transactions because you can never tell if it's a safe link or not. It will be quite impossible for the ordinary user to determine this without checking the root connectivity of this public Wi-Fi.
Are there any technological advancements or encryption methods being employed to mitigate the risks associated with public Wi-Fi usage for financial transactions?
There are actually no encryption in terms of public Wi-Fi. Mm. It was designed for public use. So public convenience is the ultimate design of this public Wi-Fi. So there is very, very low safety precautions as far as these systems are concerned. And it is the least protected systems.
Lastly, Yusek, considering the evolving nature of cyber crimes, how is the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordination Center, you know, adapting its strategies and awareness campaigns to stay ahead of scammers and also, of course, protect the public effectively? Do you have any upcoming initiatives or collaborations with either government agencies or cybersecurity experts or the private sector to enhance the overall cybersecurity landscape in the country?
But right now, we continuously build public relations. We continuously reach out to the communities. In fact, we have this ScamWatch program wherein we encourage the participation of the general public. It's no longer scammers. The major syndicated operations don't target institutions. They target individuals already. So we have to reach out to the common users of the ordinary users of technology, Wi-Fi, cell phones, to be wary of all these scams. And it's a never-ending thing. That is one thing we have to accept. It evolves very fast because of technology. We have artificial intelligence, designing schemes on how to victimize people, adapting the online behavior of the users. So all of these things are already happening around us. And the only way to do that is we have to have a public-private partnership. We have the individuals reaching out to us. We want them to report to us who are these numbers, who are these persons, whether in SOCMED, doing these things. They have to report that to us so that we can have a better strategy and better alert system. In fact, one of those that we have recently activated is the online access monitoring system, wherein we monitor the behavior of online platforms that are regularly used. Okay, so we can come out with an alert. How's the connectivity? How's the performance of each application that is commonly used? And we encourage everybody to take part, to be vigilant. This is not the sole responsibility of the government. Each of us has a responsibility and accountability with the use of these modern technologies.
Yusek Alexander Ramos of the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center. Yusek, thank you so much for joining us.
Okay, thank you first.